Good morning, everyone. My name is Judy L. Longenecker. I want to welcome you to this worship service at Emmanuel Baptist Church in Willowdale, Toronto. Wherever you are watching from today, I invite you to participate in this service, and I pray that you will feel the touch of God's Spirit as you join us in worship. Now let us prepare our hearts and minds as we listen to this morning's prelude.
Good morning, Emmanuel. Here's a scripture reading this morning from Matthew chapter 9. Jesus went through all the towns and villages, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and healing every disease and sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. And he said to the disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field." As we prepare for worship, let us be found among those who are sent into the harvest. Let us pray. Dear Father in heaven, we thank you for this day that we can reflect on your call to the mission field. We thank you for the opportunities that we have to serve you each day. And we pray that you'll find us faithful as we continue to give our lives in service to you. May we declare your goodness in all places at all times for the sake of the gospel and the kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Now let us sing in worship about the great, great love of Jesus.
Welcome to Kids Care Vids, your channel for discovering your part in God's mission. Hi, I'm Louise. Well, I've been looking back at the amazing time that I had in El Salvador last year. I traveled there with a SENT team who were working to bring justice by helping to build toilets. We did this because God wants everyone to be healthy, and we can help with that. It's surprising to think about, but there are places like El Salvador where whole communities don't have access to clean and safe washrooms. That means that every time you need to go, you have to find a bush or use a hole in the ground. And it's not safe for you or the environment. There's no protection from the elements, there's no privacy, and there's definitely no place to wash your hands. Worse than that, the human waste that's left behind can get into the local water supply. This waste can make people extremely sick and sometimes even kill them. Not having access to a bathroom is a big problem. El Salvador is the smallest country in Central America. This tiny country has lots of volcanoes. The volcanoes spew lava, which over many years creates fertile farmland where farmers can grow coffee beans. High in the mountains, at the summit of Monte Cristo Mountain, is a cloud forest in the International Nature Preserve of El Trofeo. The cloud forest is home to orchids, ferns, spider monkeys, jaguars, anteaters, and many bird species, including green toucans. It was such a cool place to visit, and I'll show you a little bit of what I did last year. Check this out.
I'm here in beautiful, hot El Salvador, where we're working with a scent team to bring justice to people in this community by building toilets. This is my friend Jenna, and she's here in El Salvador helping the team this week. Jenna, how is building toilets connected with justice?
So everybody should have a safe place to use the bathroom. So when I found out that people in El Salvador were using the bathroom out in the open and didn't have a safe place to go, I just had to come and help.
It looks like it's fun building latrines. Are you having a good time?
Yeah, it's so much fun, but it's also a lot of hard work. So when this latrine is finished, it will mean that all the people here will have a safe and clean place to use the bathroom, and it will reduce the amount of human waste that ends up in their clean drinking water.
Well, isn't that incredible? That scent team gave up their March break vacation to work hard so that others could be healthy. In the Bible, in Psalm 145, verse 9, it says, "The Lord is good to all. He has compassion on all he has made." So maybe we should follow the team's example and try to be compassionate too. And here's the thing, you don't have to travel all the way to El Salvador to start helping others. You can start helping your neighbors be healthy by volunteering at a local organization. Maybe you could help out at a retirement home or organize a food drive for your local food bank. Whatever you decide to do, it'll be a great way to help others be healthy. I'll see you next time.
Hello, Emmanuel. The scripture for today is taken from 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 8 to 10. Above all, love each other deeply, because love covers over a multitude of sins. Offer hospitality to one another without grumbling. Each of you should use whatever gift you have received to serve others, as a faithful steward of God's grace in its various forms.
Good morning, Emmanuel. It's good to be with you this morning, and I'm standing on a little island called Quadra Island, and on my left behind me is a place called Campbell River. That's where we live. I'm on Wiwaikai First Nations territory, and there are three other bands in this small area as well. Often there are orcas and humpback whales cruise past here. And so I've come up the shoreline a bit because I've seen those National Geographic films where an orca will come up on the beach and grab a seal or a penguin, and I didn't want there to be any mistaken identity, so I think I'm a safe distance from the water here. And I'm very grateful for you, Emmanuel, for what you've done in backing us up over the years. We have been over 30 years in First Nations ministry in Northern and Western Canada. And now I go and visit and supervise ministry staff from New Mexico to Northern BC. And it's an amazing experience and blessing to be able to see this big picture. And Lynn is just as much a part of it as I am. Our kids are all grown and flown the coop, and they're doing well, and we're very thankful for that. But, you know, life is not always easy. life is often hard. Sometimes it's mostly hard. And Emmanuel, you've stood with us through hard times. We've gone through periods of grief, and you've been there with us. We've gone through periods of just dry spells, and you prayed through those times with us. I would like to share a story of a colleague of mine who started in a very similar community to us, as we started in Dees Lake, a northern remote community. Well, they started in another one, very similar, First Nations village. And they moved there. They could have stayed where they were from in the States, but they moved there and they decided, we're going to raise our family here. Early one morning, their four-year-old daughter was abducted out of her bed and out the window. Long story short, she was badly injured. Her skull was crushed by this very deranged person, and her father found her lying in a creek bed, very badly injured. And the good news is she's doing great today. She's a nurse, full-time nurse, working in a hospital. But at the time, they didn't know if she was going to live or die. She had massive skull fractures and significant brain injury. But they had people telling them, you know what, you need to get out of there. You need to move. This is obviously an evil and terrible place to raise children. And they thought, no, it never entered their minds until somebody said it, but they thought, no, we've been sent here. And this is part of living in this community and experiencing what these people experience. And it's kind of like just what Jesus did with us. Like he became one of us. And so they stayed. That was over 38 years ago that this incident occurred. I spoke with him just this week, and he said, if I could just share with you what some of the things that have happened since then. He said, just pre-COVID, there was a youth group of 15 to 20 First Nations youth meeting in our home every week for Bible study. Okay, he said, we have good snacks, we have goofy games, we have great singing, and we have Bible study. And he said, the kids are loving it. They love it. And there are some that age out of the youth group, but they don't want to leave. So they stick around and they just pretend they're teenagers. But that might not sound like a very big youth group to you, 15 to 20 people, but in a First Nations village, that's mega. That's huge. And so God is using them, and they're full of joy. And that's like a long haul they lived in this community where many people told them, get out. But they had hard times in Dees Lake where we were. We had hard times. Things didn't go the way we thought they would go. Our goals and our objectives were almost a joke by the time we left. But people had come to the Lord, and people had transformed their lives. But our goal of church planting had fallen to pieces. See, we had been trained as church planters and sent with all these, tidy objectives. And in 3 or 4 years, we were supposed to be done and then move on to the next community. What they neglected to tell us, the people who trained us, is that this has actually never worked before in Canada in a First Nations community. But you go try the same thing, expecting different results. So, needless to say, I was defeated and disappointed in many ways. Even a lot of my friends took their own lives. There was things around us we couldn't understand, comprehend, and didn't seem to be able to help. But we had a small core of believers that grew in the Lord and shared and shined their light, even though life was hard. There's a man named Daniel you may have heard of, and I was just reading Daniel the other day, and I was impressed at how relatable it was this time. And he wasn't some far-off movie star, celebrity, Bible figure that's so far above us. He had a hard life. And if you have had a hard life, you should be able to relate to Daniel. It takes about an hour to read the whole book. But he was captured as a young man. He probably saw his home city, Jerusalem, turned into rubble. Probably he saw his family and all his friends massacred. And only he and a select few of Jewish survivors were taken back to Babylon as war trophies, slaves, and captives for life. They would never return to their homeland. Kilometers from home, about a 20-day walk, and they would never return. And so in Babylon, yeah, they really excelled. Daniel and his friends, they did very well. God gave them wisdom, and they stayed true to the Lord, but they were under constant pressure, constant cultural pressure to conform to the norms of that society, religious persecution. And it culminated in the case of the three of Daniel's friends, that you know the story, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, thrown into a blast furnace, and I think Daniel probably witnessed that. He also witnessed that God delivered them out of that furnace without a hair singed, not even smelling like smoke, but a stressful experience to be sure, and yet he saw the faithfulness of God. All through their experience there, they just stayed steady. They stayed true to the Lord. They wanted to please Him and love Him with their lives. And so they just kind of shone a steady light. And they, you know, Daniel watched the kingdom of Babylon fall and the next kingdom rise, the Medes and the Persians. He served the king Darius and then Cyrus. And once again, massive religious persecution, as we would call it today, and where there was conspiracy and he was set up so that just by praying to the one true God, he would be basically framed and thrown into a den of starving lions that were supposed to tear him apart and eat him. Eat anyone that didn't worship the king. And you know that, I mean, that's the famous little postage stamp version of Daniel's story, is thrown into the lion's den. Well, that was just one part of his story of a hard life. And yeah, the lions didn't eat him, but if you've ever sat with a group of starving lions overnight, I haven't, but maybe you have, and it probably was an extremely stressful situation, and yet he was pulled out unharmed, and a great victory for God. And then later, he had visions, not just nice, God loves you visions, but disturbing visions he didn't understand, and every time he had one, it would take a toll physiologically, where he'd be just kind of devastated for a while. In one case, he said, after these visions, I was ill for several days. That's the type of vision he would have. And he was just, you know, mystified by a lot of these things. And finally, at the end of Daniel in chapter 12, he asked a question to one of the beings that was giving him these visions. Angelic beings, I believe. He writes this: I heard, but I did not understand. So I asked, my Lord, what will the outcome of all this be? He replied, go your way, Daniel, because the words are closed up and sealed until the time of the end. What an answer. All he wanted to know is, I don't understand. What is all this going to mean? What does all this mean? And his answer? Go your way. You do not need to know this. This is not for you. It's for the end. And then at the end of the chapter, the last verse, it's kind of repeated. It says, like, as for you, go your way till the end. You will rest. And then at the end of the days, you will rise to receive your allotted inheritance. That's a nice way of saying you're going to die. But at the end of the days, you will rise to receive your allotted inheritance. And I believe that's the message that we need to hear as well. We don't need to understand all these things. We don't even understand why our life is hard. Here's the thing. You will rest, and at the end of the days, you will rise. We will rise to receive our allotted inheritance. And that's an amazing reality and promise. But in the meantime, often life is really difficult to understand. Why did this happen to me? Why is this happening to me? Why am I sick? Why am I in the hospital? Why am I broke? So many things. But we need to remain steady and just worship. Just love God. Love people. Be consistent messengers of His goodness and grace. And that's what God wanted from Daniel. See, because of his life of hard experiences and Daniel's staying true and worshiping and praying and being steady, he was then highly esteemed by God and was a reliable messenger for these valuable and precious prophecies that are worth a lot for us today and in the future. So we don't even know what God is up to in the big picture, but He is to be trusted. He's a loving, kind, and wonderful God. And His heart is for the nations. We know this because Jesus' last command was, go into all the world and preach the gospel, making disciples of every nation, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them everything, to obey everything I've taught you. The nations go into all the world. I mean, this was before it was cool to be, you know, just focused on our own little ethnic minority or ethnic group or our own nation. And the heart of God has always been every nation. So when I see Emmanuel, your mission statement, gathering the nations to reach the nations, I'm like, I get to be part of this. And that is being part of the kingdom of God. If we're on track with that, we're on track with His heart. And so we just praise God that we're able to be part of what You're doing in the world. You're able to support us over all these years. And what a blessing and privilege. And, you know, I could tell you stories all day long about what God is doing among First Nations from Northern BC to New Mexico and everywhere in between, because First Nations are precious to Him. And so thank you for backing us up. And you've been a blessing to us, and you continue to be a blessing. We look forward to what God has for us in the future, and we look forward to being with you. We hope soon. May the Lord bless you and continue your ministry powerfully. Thank you.
the Lord of snow and rain. I have borne my people's pain. I have wept for love of them. They turn away. I will break their hearts of stone. Give them hearts for love alone. I will speak my word to them. Whom shall
My name is Bai Ojo. Let us bow our heads as we pray together. Our Father and our Lord, we thank you. We thank you for your love and protection over us. We thank you for your provision and your banner of love and of love over us day and night. We thank you for your church, Emmanuel Baptist Church. Your love kept us together as a vibrant community in this corner of Finch and Don Mills. For this, we thank you, Lord. I pray for the sick ones amongst us, Lord God. I pray for healing for Nadia's in-laws, the father-in-law, the mother-in-law, sister-in-law, the brother-in-law, and their son, who are currently sick from COVID-19. Lord, you are the great physician. You are our healer, according to your word. Please, Lord, give health and healing to this family and restore their vitality in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. I pray especially for the father-in-law who seems to be most affected by COVID-19. Please, Lord, heal and restore his health and make him whole from this disease. Lord, I also ask that you protect Nadia and family from COVID-19 as she takes on the responsibility of providing for her in-laws. Lord, I pray for anyone in our congregation who may be experiencing any form of sickness. I pray, Lord, that you will touch them with your healing hands and restore their health in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. I pray for those amongst us, Lord, who might be experiencing emotional diseases like hopelessness, distress, anxiety, depression, and any other disease, especially now due to this isolation from COVID-19. Lord, you are our hope and our strong fortress. Give them the wisdom to cast all of their burdens upon you, Lord, because you care for them much more than they can even comprehend. I pray that they will be reminded of your love and faithfulness to them, especially in this time of distress. I thank you, Lord, for our ministers and the different ministries in our church. I pray that you will be with them, Lord, and their families and meet all of their needs according to your riches in glory. I pray for our missionaries, Don and Ruth Passy in Chile, Remy and Philip in Switzerland, Brent and Lynn Ostring in BC, and any other missionaries and locally and internationally. Lord, I thank you for your provision for these people. Thank you for meeting all of their needs, especially in this period of COVID-19, when many churches and people are struggling with their finances. Thank you, Lord, for meeting all of their needs according to your riches in glory. I pray for our minister today, Mr. Brent Ostring. I pray, Lord, that the words of his mouth will come true with power and authority, and it will minister to your people. I pray for the troubled countries around the world, Lord. Thank you for the ceasefire between Israel and the Palestinians. I pray, Lord, that they will find way forward in their troubles, that peace may reign supreme in that part of the world. Also, at this time, Lord, I pray for Lebanon and the situation that is going on there. I pray, Holy God, that you will bring peace to that country. Oh, Lord, this was a beautiful country that has been destroyed by so many power struggles. I pray, Lord, that you will restore hope to the people and help maintain and let peace reign supreme in that country. Also, Lord, I pray for other countries in the world, including Nigeria, Syria, and many other countries where there is trouble, Lord God. Please help them to maintain peace and let peace reign. I pray for peace in all of these COVID hotspots, Lord. I pray that you will protect your people. And Lord, I pray for our government leaders at home and abroad. I pray that you will grant them wisdom and the courage to lead your people with integrity and fairness. I pray for us in Ontario as the government is preparing for reopening of the economy. I pray, Lord, that the people will have the courage to do the right thing so we don't have to go into lockdown again in the fall. I pray also, as we are likely to be reopening for in-person worship very soon, help us all, Lord, to be safe. And help us to make the right and wise decision about COVID-19 vaccines. As we go into summer, Lord, I pray for safety and protection for all of us, especially for our children, as they play together with their friends and other kids whom they haven't seen for a very long time. I pray, Lord, that you keep them safe and protect them. Lord, we celebrate with people in our church who are celebrating. We thank you, Lord, for many birthdays in the month of May and April and other months. And we thank you for people who are getting job, finding jobs, and people who are getting job promotions, and you know, wedding anniversary, birthday anniversary, and so many other celebrations, Lord. We give you thanks for all of these and much more. We thank you, Lord, for you are our God and our Father, and you really care and love us. Please, Lord, accept our prayers, since we ask all of this in the mighty name of our Lord and King Jesus Christ. Amen.
Chains are gone.
Morning, Emmanuel. This is the time in our service where we take up our offering. We appreciate and are so thankful for your faithfulness in giving and supporting our ministries at Emmanuel in different ways, such as giving your time, finances, encouragement, and prayers. We really appreciate it, and it means a lot. If you don't know already, there are several ways that you can send in your offerings. You can give online, you can also drop off your offering at the church in the mail slot, or you can send it in the mail as well. May we live out Acts 2, verses 42 and 47, which says this: "They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved." This is our prayer for our church today. Join me as I pray for our ministries and our offerings. God, we are so thankful that you provide for all of our needs. We pray that we would add to our numbers each day. We pray that we would help those in need. We pray that our ministries and church community would be there for each other, break bread with each other, and pray for one another. We pray that we would continue to grow in our faiths and walks, and we pray that our church would be blessed by living out our calling together. We pray that you bless our volunteers, leaders, and our community as a whole as we serve and help out in so many different ways. We pray for our offerings, and we ask that you continue to provide everything that we need. We pray for all of these things in your name. Amen. Bye! Morning, Emmanuel. We are so happy that you joined us today. These are our opportunities for this Sunday. Did you know that we have a prayer ministry that gathers on Zoom every Sunday at 8:30 to 9:30 a.m. to pray for our worship services, ministries, and church community? If you would like to be a part of this ministry, please contact the office for more information. The power of prayer is amazing. Also, did you know that we have a time for fellowship after the church service each Sunday? Pour yourself a cup of coffee or some iced tea and join Pastor Jonathan on Zoom from 11 a.m. to 12 p.m. The link can be found on our streaming service page at emmanuelbaptist.ca. We also have Sunday school for kids from grades JK to grade 5 available each Sunday online every week. For more information, please contact the office on how to get your children involved in our kids' ministries. We would love to see them there. We also have a thriving youth ministry available for youth in grades 6 to 12. We meet every other Friday at 7 p.m. on Zoom. Currently, we are doing a series on identity. not be shaken by the storms of life. We also meet every Sunday at 3 p.m. on Zoom. Currently, we're doing a series called Back to Basics, where we're doing an overview of the Bible and how to read the Bible. For more information, please contact the office or myself on how to get your youth involved. Also, on June 5th from 1 to 4 p.m., Council would like to invite those who are involved in our ministries, such as leaders and volunteers throughout our church community, to come together on Zoom to talk about the upcoming year. A link for this meeting, this Zoom call, will be posted at a later date. This is our benediction for today. It comes from Philemon 1, verses 4 to 7, and it says this: I always thank my God as I remember you in my prayers, because I hear about your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all the saints. I pray that you may be active in sharing your faith so that you will have a full understanding of every good thing we have in Christ. Your love has given me great joy and encouragement, because you, brothers and sisters, have refreshed the hearts of the saints.